बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम डियर स्टूडेंट्स। आई इंजीनियर शाद मोहम्मद, लेक्चरर एट डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सिविल इंजीनियरिंग, कॉमसेट्स यूनिवर्सिटी इस्लामाबाद, साहिवाल कैंपस। वेलकम यू ऑल टू आवर लेक्चर नंबर 24th ऑफ द सिविल इंजीनियरिंग कंस्ट्रक्शन एंड ग्राफिक्स। एंड टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग प्री स्ट्रेस, स्पेसिफिकली प्री टेंशन कंक्रीट कंस्ट्रक्शन। So pre-stressing have two different phenomena, pre-tensioning and post-tensioning, and we will only be studying pre-tensioning concrete construction in our today's lecture, and in upcoming lecture, that is lecture number 25, we will study pre-stressing as per post-tensioning concrete construction. All right, in our previous lecture, lecture number 23 of the was related to precast concrete construction, and we studied that precast concrete construction have a lot of applications in our modern civil engineering industry, and with the day-to-day we are getting lesser space for our construction practices, and high-rise buildings need a lot of open area for cast in situ concreting, which is mostly readily not available. So we prefer precast concrete construction, and mostly the in situ quality of the ensuring quality of the concrete is quite difficult, so we prefer precast concrete construction. So there are many benefits and advantages of precast concrete construction, and we study in detail different precast concrete products and different elements of the building for which precast have been formulated, and advantages and disadvantages, and precast concrete molds, and we studied precast concrete buildings, and we categorized them in large panel systems and frame systems, and we studied different connections of the frame system, column to base and column to column, and slab to beam and column to beam, and we studied frame system, slab column system with shear wall, frame having a shear wall. We also studied a slab column system with shear wall, and precast concrete construction process procedure. We also studied some precautionary and preventive measures during casting and plant, during plant and at plant, and during transportation and during erection of the precast concrete elements, and care on the sites, and erection sequence, safety, tolerance, rigging, temporary bracing, level shims, propping, joint connections. We study in detail joint connections and cost in connections, lift inserts, surface finishes, pre-concrete checks, placing, demolding, curing, handling, lifting equipments, and factory and site storage, transportation, erection of that site, and quality assurance system, and building precast concrete projects examples. So very extensively we discussed precast concrete construction, and in our today's lecture, that is pre-stress pre-tension concrete construction, we will be studying brief history of the pre-tensioning and different pre-stress and pre-tension concrete types and types of reinforcements, and deformed mild steel reinforcement, and we will study stress strain curve and different forms of pre-stressing steel, so wires, strands, tendons, cables, bars, what are the differences in between them, and type of pre-stressing steel. Okay, so properties of pre-stressing steels and pre-tension concrete construction, what is it, and we will introduce it properly, and advantages of and disadvantages of pre-stressing, comparison between reinforced cement concrete and pre-stressed concrete. So we also discuss internal pre-stressing, external pre-stressing, types of pre-stressing and methods of pre-stressing, that includes hydraulic pre-stressing, mechanical pre-stressing, electrical pre-stressing, and chemical pre-stressing. So it will be a very interesting topic, and let's start it properly. Okay, brief history of the pre-tensioning. Before pre-tensioning, there were a lot of exemplary developments in the field of concrete and steel. So two significant development of the reinforced concrete are the inventions of the Portland cement and introduction of the steel in concrete. So why concrete steel was introduced in this concrete you know, for as concrete is almost 10%, having 10% tensile strength as compared to its compressive strength. So concrete is quite weaker in tensile stress, in resisting tensile stresses. So to cover that weakness, we introduce steel, where concrete members are subjected to tensile stresses. So the major developments were the cement and introduction of sealing the concrete. So Joseph Espandin in 1824, he belonged to England and he obtained a patent for manufacture of the Portland cement. So this Portland cement is referred to Joseph Espandin, and Monnier belonged to France, and in 1857. So he introduced steel wires and concrete to make flower pots, pipes, arches and slabs. In 1857 he used steel wires to formulate different types of elements or assemblies. In 1886, Jackson of USA introduced the concept of tightening steel tie rods in artificial stones and concrete arches. So a tie rod was incorporated and tightened at its edges, and this was introduced by Jackson. And in 1888, Doering of Germany manufactured concrete slabs and small beams with embedded tension steel. So RCC was properly introduced, and by Doering, he belonged to Germany, and Steiner of USA in 1908 recognized the losses due to shrinkage and creep. So these are the two major phenomena in weaknesses of the concrete. Concrete can shrink and concrete can creep. This is basically due to the bonding compounds, which is cement, and due to which losses occur in the steel. And suggested steel or concrete member, and suggested tightening the rods to recover the lost pre-stress. Emperger of Austria developed a method of winding and pre-tensioning high tensile steel wires around the concrete pipes. So around the concrete pipes he was the first to introduce pre-tensioning. So Hewitt of USA in 1924 introduced hoop stressed horizontal reinforcement around walls of concrete tanks through the use of turnbuckles, and thousands of liquid storage tanks and concrete pipes were built in the two decades to follow. So due to Hewitt, he introduced hoop stressed and horizontal reinforcement in storage tanks and concrete pipes. Dill, USA, he used high strength unbonded steel rods. The rods were tensioned and anchored after a hardening of the concrete. Okay, steel rods, high tension steel rods were introduced by Dills. Not introduced, but they were used in concrete. Frenzient of France. So Frenzient of France, he is known as the father of pre-stressed concrete and today's topic. And used high tensile steel wires with ultimate strength as high as 1725 megapascal and yield stress over 1240 megapascal. In 1939 he developed conical wedges for end anchorages of post tensioning and developed double acting jacks. He is also referred to as father of pre-stressed concrete. So Eugen Frenzient of France is known as father of concrete. All right, this brief history is important as per your mostly MCQs parts, and you should be knowing if you are specializing in your pre-stress concrete. So you should be knowing the detailed history of the pre-stress, how it was developed and why it was developed, and who were the introducers of these pre-stressing and different aspects of the development in history of the concrete and reinforced concrete and pre-stress concrete. Okay, pre-stress and pre-tension concrete construction. Types of steel reinforcement generally used are plain mild steel reinforcing steel These are the plain mild steel reinforcements and deformed mild steel reinforcements. Deformed mild steel, this one is deformed mild steel reinforcement. Pre-stressed steel includes 7 wire strands. So 7 wire strands, this one, and bar, pre-stressed bar and pre-stressed wires and welded wire frame reinforcement. Reinforcement is welded together. So these are generally different types of steel reinforcement, high strength steel reinforcement, and more alloys can be introduced based on the materials. So previously mild steel would be used, this plain mild steel would be used in our previous constructions, but due to quite advancement in research, and they would slip from the concrete when tensile, when they were subjected to tensile stresses. So this slipping phenomena would be quite harmful for means they would not resist as efficient that tensile stresses as they were meant to. So a deformation on the surface of the plain reinforcement was introduced, and this was having deformed bars were having quite better bonding or anchorages bonding with the reinforced concrete. Okay, this is interesting that a typical deformed bar looks like this and typical plain bar looks like this, and this is there is an engravement on the deformed bar. So deformed bar does not mean that it is deformed or it is having an angle, but it means that it is having a surface deformation on its surface. So what are the different nomenclature of these representing? So H, if there is an H written or some S or P or K, then that is that refers to the point of origin, that is the letters or symbols of the producing mill. So industry have their own representation, so they represent their symbol or here. That like Mogul Steel will be written as M or something like that. So then there is a number 11. So this is a size designation. You know that reinforcement bars come in different sizes, starting from 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 14, and 18. So these are number of bar number. Not quantity but number bar. So this is as per ASTM standards, and okay, and then in metric system this is like this one. Okay, type of steel, this is type of the steel that if S is written, that carbon steel, following quality, and this is W, low alloy steel, SS stainless steel, R rail steel, I rail steel, A axle steel, CS low carbon chromium. So these are different types of steels, and based on the material, and these are its specifications, and they will be following specification of the ASTM A615 committee, and these are metric units, codes in metric units. All right, this is 60. This represents the minimum yield designation grade mark or grade line. This is the grade of the reinforcing bar. What are grades of the reinforcing bar? It will come in upcoming slides. These show the minimum yield strength of the reinforcing bar. You have studied yielding and complete stress strain curve in your mechanics of materials or mechanics of solids. So this is it can be 60 75 80 100 120, and none. If there is no representation over here, then it will be grade 440 or 50, and in metric marking it will be 280 or 350. And if there is 60, then it will be grade 60, 75, grade 75, 80, grade 80, and similarly. Okay, if there is marking 4, 5, 6, 6, 8, then it will be representing this one. All right. These are different dia of the reinforcement bars, and how are you going to calculate the dia? Means just with the help of vernier caliper, just place them over here and open the vernier caliper, and you can measure at three different points. You can measure and take the average. That will be the dia of the bar. So this is a dia 10 mm, 12 mm, 16 mm. This is in metric or SI units, and okay, these are different deformations on the deform mild steel reinforcement, herring bone shape, and crescent shape, and spiral shape. So typically low number of bars having herring bone shape, and higher it goes in the then crescent shape and spiral shapes. Alright, then deformed mild steel reinforcement, these are the bar designations and nominal weight and diameter of the reinforcement and cross-sectional area of the bar and perimeter of the bar. So bar designation are basically from 3, 4, 5 to till 18, and few are missing. So in metric units they are 3 will be representing 10 and 4 will be representing 13, and similarly like this one. And nominal weight, pounds per feet. 1 foot will have this much pounds of weight, and in metric units it will be having 1 meter will be having this much kg of weight, if that is bar number 3, and greater the number of the bar, greater will be its unit weight. And diameter represents that what is the dia of the bar. If that is number 3, then this much inches, and 4 it this much inches, and 5 and this end. It can easily be calculated by if you are dividing 3 divided by 8, so you will get this one, and all 18 divided by 8, so you will get this one. So inches, this is the diameter, and it can be converted into millimeters. So if you are using a metric system, then you are following this one. And cross-sectional area, so this is area pi d square divided by 4, a typical circular reinforcement bar formula for calculating area. And perimeter is the total length of its surface, circular surface. Alright, in design and analysis you require this dia and cross-sectional area, and in quantity survey you require also the weight per feet. Deform mild steel reinforcement, and this is a detailed specification of mild steel, and it will belong to ASTM codes category A and community number 615. So grade 40, grade 60, grade 75, grade 80, and grade 90, 100, and 120, and 100 and plus. So A706, grade 60, and different other categories. So you can see that physical properties are given, and grade code and available bar sizes are given. You have yield strength, minimum yield strength in PSI of grade 40 is 40,000 PSI pound per square inch, and yield strength maximum, minimum yield strength, and you know that in stress strength there is maximum and minimum yield strength. So minimum yield strength is 40,000, and for grade 60 it is 60,000, and grade 75 and 80 it is respectively thousands. Just multiply 1000 with the number of the grade, so you will get the minimum yield strength. So minimum yield strength and maximum tensile, minimum tensile strength in PSI is 60,000 of grade 640, and 90,000 for grade 60, and 100,000 for grade 75, and 105,000 for grade 80. These are ASTM standards, so we'll be following ASTM standards, and these are you can see that grade 40 there is no written writing over here, and for grade 60 it is written 60, and this is S will represent the company, and XS will represent the number of the bar, and S will represent the mild steel. You can see that S represent carbon steel, and here S is written carbon steel, and W will represent low alloy steels. So, and okay, this one 75 and grade 80. All right, grade code marking on the bar 3, 4, 5. This is number of the bar, bar size. XS represent bar size, and bar size is available 3. If that is number 3, and then elongation, minimum elongation will be 11%. And how you are going to calculate the elongation, you must be knowing in your previous lecture, and bending 3.5D, and you will have conducted bending tests. And so greater the number of the bar, greater the elongation, alright. And okay, if you are increasing the grade, then in same number of the bar, if you are increasing the grade quality of the reinforcement, then elongation will reduce. And you can see that the lower the grade of the reinforcement, the higher the ductility, and lower the higher the grade of the reinforcement, the lower the ductility, because ductility is an indirect measure of the elongation, is an indirect measure of ductility. Alright, in Pakistan you must have heard some terminologies, and so these are local terminologies regarding different bar sizes. You must be remembering them. Alright, different grades. Okay, this is representation, quite refined representation. Stress strain curve in KSI. So grade 40 KSI have minimum yield strength of 40 KSI, and grade 60 is 60 KSI, and 80 is 80 KSI, and 120. So that is minimum and maximum. Minimum tensile strength is of grade 40 is 60, and grade 60 is almost 90 KSI, and something like that, as given in our previous in our previous this one, in this table it is given at yield strength. Alright, you can see that in this graph that the lower the grade of the reinforcement, keeping the bar size, bar number same, so the lower the grade of the reinforcement, the higher the ductility. The higher the grade of the reinforcement, the lower the ductility. So grade and ductility are inversely proportional. If you are increasing the grade, ductility will reduce, and if you are increasing the ductility, then grade will reduce. And here you can see that yield strength have been calculated at 0.002. So yield strength of 120 is minimum yield strength is 120. So when yield curve is not smooth, so you can take an offset of the modulus of elasticity, and 2% of the modulus of elasticity offset. Alright, in megapascal, it is given here in KSI, and here it is converted into megapascal. So equivalency of different units has been done. Okay, steel reinforcement stress strain curve, you have definitely studied it in more detail. Young modulus, how you are going to calculate the Young modulus, that is just equivalent to the slope, and there is a proportional limit, elastic limit, and yield strength, minimum yield strength, maximum yield strength, and then there is phenomenon of strain hardening and strain softening, and ultimate tensile strength, and necking phenomena, and fracture. And there is a toughness and modulus of resilience, and many terminologies that can have a separate lecture on them, but you have studied them in detail in your previous lectures. So okay, this is an interesting, that with the change in temperature, how your tensile strength is affected. So you can see that if your bar is having 180 KSI tensile strength, so with the change in temperature from 24 degree, if that is rising to 93, that rise to 93 degree, then it will reduce its then 204, and you can see that if temperature increases to 538, then your bar of 180 KSI yield strength will reduce its tensile strength to 60 KSI. So this aspect is very important when considering fire. Your building is under fire and you have not provided quite good cover, concrete cover or some other fire resisting mechanism. So these are very important for making your mind clear that temperature have very drastic and dangerous effect on your tensile strength of the reinforcement. Okay, you can see that comparison has been carried out that in typical reinforcement bar, my steel reinforcement bar rate 60, and other bars and wires and strands, you can see 270 KSI and 300 KSI. So where is 60,000 KSI and 300,000 KSI? So, and this is also a comparison between mild steel and pre-stressing steel. Mild steel start from zero and then it's typical stress strain curve, and pre-stressing steel have 227 or 240 or 300 even KSI strengths. Okay, why this curve is little across here, then this is the phenomena that we will discuss in upcoming lectures, upcoming slides. Forms of pre-stressing steel. The development of pre-stressed concrete was influenced by the invention of high-strength steel. So means there was conventionally mild steel, and with the introduction of high-strength steel, researchers came to know that we should be working on pre-stressed concrete in an alloy of iron. It is an alloy of iron, carbon, manganese, and optional materials. So steel, pre-stressing steel is also an alloy, like normal mild steel reinforcement is an alloy. So it is an alloy of iron. So almost 85 to 90% is iron, and then almost 90 to 95% is iron, and in some percentages there is carbon and manganese and other different minerals. So in addition, elements. So in addition to pre-stressing steel, conventional non-pre-stressed reinforcement is used for flexural capacity, optional shear capacity, temperature and shrinkage reinforcement. So when you are providing steel, pre-stressing steel, it doesn't mean that you are not providing conventional normal mild steel reinforcement. It means that in addition to pre-stressing steel, you have to provide non-pre-stressed normal reinforcement to resist the flexural capacity, shear capacity, temperature and shrinkage reinforcements. You will study in reinforced concrete design that temperature and shrinkage reinforcement, they are provided to resist the temperatural and thermal changes and thermal stresses, and shear capacity and flexural against the bending and shear. Alright, forms of pre-stressing steel, that includes number one, wires. A pre-stressing wire is a single unit made of steel. So it is, a wire is a single unit and it is made of steel, and nominal diameter of the wire is 2.5, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8 mm. So the different dia of the wires and different types of wires are as follows. So wires are single unit of the steel, pre-stressing steel, and they are plain wires and indented wires. Plain wires have no indentation on the surface, as and indented wire have circular or elliptical indentation on the surface. So as shown in the picture, these are indented wires. Means this is a in wires, there is also a category similar to the deformed and non-deformed mild steel reinforcement. There are plain wires and indented wires. So there were plain reinforcement bars and deformed reinforcement bars in conventional steel. Strands. A few wires are spun together in a helical form to form a pre-stressing strand. So they are spun together in a helical form, twisted around So different types of strands are as follows: 2-wire strands, 3-wire strands, and 7-wire strands. 2-wire strands, 2 wires are spun together to form a strand. So this is 3-wire strand, and this is 7-wire strand, and this is also 7-wire strand, and changing in the dia. So 3 wires are spun together to form the strand are called 3-wire strand, and 7-wire strands. In this type of strand, 6 wires are spun together in as around a central wire. This is important that in 7-wire strand, all the wires are not spun around each other, but in 7-wire strand, the center is kept constant, and all other wires are spun around the central wire. So you can expect that wires are separate individual units, and strands are combination of different wires, different number of wires. Tendons, a group of strands or wires are placed together to form a pre-stressing tendon. So a group of strands or wires is called tendon. A tendon are used in post-tensioned members. So these are mostly used in post-tensioned members, and pre-stressing strands are mostly used in pre-stressing steel, and tendons are mostly used in post-tensioning members. So what is the basic difference between post-tensioning and pre-stressing, pre-tensioned concrete and post-tensioned concrete? These are basically two different categories of pre-stressing steel, pre-stressing concrete. Pre-tensioned concrete, tensioning is applied before casting of the concrete, and in post-tension concrete, tensioning in the tendons or strands are applied after casting of the concrete. The following figures show the cross-section of the typical tendons. The strands are placed in a duct which may be filled with grout after the post-tensioning operation is complete. So this is your duct containing different tendons, and this there is openness, and this will be filled with the grout, and we have studied that grout is the slurry or a combination of cement and certain quantity of water. This is your tendon in post-tension concrete. So you can see that this is concrete, and concrete has been hardened, and then steel, this tendons have been placed. Wires have been placed and to formulate a tendon, and then anchorage has been placed, and wedges are placed. So you know, before post tensioning is carried out, these wires are tensioned, and then wedges are placed. So this is also ducts and carrying the tendons. Cables. A group of tendons form a pre-stressing cable, and cables are used in bridges. So many tendons are joined together to form cables. And these are mostly used in bridges. Bars. A tendon can be made of a single steel bar. Alright, a tendon can be, means they can be fused together to form a single steel bar. The diameter of the bar is much larger than that of the wire. So it means you cannot mix a wire with the bar, because their dia is quite larger as compared to wire. So their dia is almost 10, 12, 16, 20, up to 32 mm. And you can see that in wires, the maximum was 8 mm. And its initial is 10 mm, so it means the least size of the bar is quite bigger than this individual wire of the pre-stressing steel. So different bars can also be applied in the pre-stressing elements. Types of pre-stressing steel, and they are cold work pre-stressed steel, and stress relieving pre-stressed steel, and strain tempering pre-stressed steel. So these are the formation, how these pre-stress are formulated, and in industry. So cold working or cold drawing, So in cold drying is done by rolling bars through a series of dies, and there are rotating chambers in which steel is passed, and it realigns the crystals and increases the strength. So this is cold working and stress relieving, and stress relieving is done by heating the strands up to 350 degrees centigrade and cooling slowly. This reduces the plastic deformation of the steel after onset of the yielding. So this also increases the strength and strengthening of the steel. So steel is basically heated, strands are heated up to 350 degrees centigrade and cooled slowly, and strain tempering for low relaxation. This process is done by heating the strands up to 350 degrees centigrade while it is under tension. This also improves the stress strain behavior of the steel by reducing the plastic deformation after the onset of the yielding. In addition, the relaxation is reduced. So these are for relaxing, for relaxation of the steel. There is no heat involved, and so basically in cold working there is no heat involved, and in the stress relieving and strain tempering heat is evolved involved, and in stress relieving basically strands are heated up to 350 degrees centigrade and slowly cooled, and it is ensured that it reduces the plastic deformation after stress strain curve passes the yielding point. And in strain tempering it is ensured that it improves the plastic, it reduces the plastic deformation, and after yielding have been achieved. Properties of the pre-stressing steel. The steel is pre-stressed. In pre-stress application has to be of good quality. It requires the following attributes. So these following attributes should be incorporated in your pre-stressing steel, and it should be high strength and adequate ductility. Ductility is very essential when your such structures are susceptible to natural earthquake loading, or you can say that wind loading, extreme wind loading, and blast loading or impact loading. Ductility is very important for your structure. If your steel is not ductile, then your whole structure or your member or element or structural compounds cannot be ductile. Bendability, which is required at the harping point at the near anchorages. So what is harping point? Harping is the bendability, bending point, and so this is a straight strand. This is a stretched strand, okay, harped. This is bended. This is harped strand, and debonded strands are just debonded separate strands. So what is being done in pre-stressing? That a steel tendons or strands are provided, and then casting of the concrete is carried out, and in the presence of normal reinforcement, conventional reinforcement. So these are tensioned at this, and then when concrete is hardened, then they are released and cut off. So they will apply compression at these edges, and they will formulate nearly a camber on the upper side. So when load is applied, so it will first be straightened. This member will first straightened, and then it will deflect, show some deflection. So half strands and debonded strands. So this shows the deformation in the original element or member due to provision of strands. High bond required for pre-tensioned members. So high bonding is required for pre-tensioned members. So they should be having your pre-stressing steel should be having good bonding with the host material, that is concrete. Roll relaxation to reduce losses. So means, as you know, that pre-stressing steel is stressed, intentionally stressed. So there should be not be any relaxation in that stressing or tensioning. So minimum corrosion, there should be least number of least corrosion to the pre-stressing steel. Alright, this is important. Pre-stressing concrete introduction. What is pre-stressing? Now we'll be discussing it in detail. Briefly, in our previous slides, we just went through different forms of pre-stressing steel and the difference between strength differences between mild steel and pre-stressing steel, and formation of different pre-stressing steel, industrial preparation, and the properties of pre-stressing. Introduction, pre-stressing, pre-tension concrete construction, and this is important why we require pre-tensioning and pre-stressing in our structures. And you can see that a beam is shown and a trailer is moving across, and simply supported beam or girder. A beam, concrete beam, begins to bend when heavily loaded, okay, at mid-span heavy load, and maximum bending will be at mid-span. So the base of the beam starts cracking where concrete is pulled apart. So you can see that due to bending, basically beneath the neutral axis, concrete will start cracking, and above the neutral axis, the concrete will start resist compression. And if you place a steel rod inside, the beam holds the concrete together and stops the beam from cracking. So if you place some reinforcement, if that is normal reinforcement or pre-stress reinforcement, and just place that inside the concrete, then that will start resisting the cracking at tensile stresses. And even if you stretch a rod and then release it to squeeze the concrete, makes the beam very strong. So if you stretch the rod or tensile strands with the help of hydraulic jacks and release these strands, on releasing these strands, will apply compressive forces at the end of these members, and compressive stresses will be developed inside, and due to compressive stresses, a camber will be formed because this member will try to shorten itself in response to tensile stresses developed by the pre-stressing steel. So a camber will be formed, and when load or trailer is passed from on the girder or beam, so trailer, what will do to due to loading, first trailer will straighten the member, and then that beam will start deflection. All right, here it is been shown the stranded concrete and pre-stressed concrete. In stranded concrete means a conventional beam has been shown, and some load weight of the people, car, or self weight is applied, and you have studied in theory of bending that where the force is applied transversely to the member, there is a compression directly beneath it, and at the other edge there will be tensile stresses. So upper layer is compressed and lower layer is tensioned. Lower layer is stretched, so cracks start initiating from the beneath the beam. So these are flexural cracks, and these bending stresses are called flexural stresses. And if you provide pre-stressed concrete, you can see a load is applied, pre-stressed concrete condition, this steel member is provided, and it has been stretched, and due to stretching when they are released, they will apply compressive forces, and due to compressive forces, this load will also be resisted by these compressive forces. So contractive forces of the pre-stressed concrete steel member is transmitted to the concrete as compressive force. So you have come to know that when compression occurs, they compress the cracks too. So cracks are suppressed due to compression, and cracks are exaggerated and more visible due to tension. So these pre-stressing helps in crack suppression. this is a typical cross section of the reinforced concrete beam, and steel is provided, and you can see that strain distribution. Upside there will be compression, and here it will be tension, and tension will be resisted, and tensile stresses, and there are compressive stresses. So below neutral axis, we assume that concrete block is not resisting tensile stresses, and all the tensile stresses are resisted by the conventional steel reinforcement. So this is your stress diagram. So in case of pre-stressing, this is a member, and a steel pre-stress steel is provided, and load is applied. You can see that stress distribution due to P. This is P. This will be as this steel is stretched and anchored at the edge of the concrete. So this will apply. Steel will try to shorten itself, and due to shortening, force of compressive force of P will be applied. So at so one another thing that this steel is provided at the bottom of the member. So at the bottom there will be greater compressive stresses. So at the bottom there is greater compressive stresses, and at the top corner there are compressive stresses, but their magnitude is quite less. So due to loading, there will be bending stresses, and bending stresses at let's assume that there is a uniform cross section. So bending stresses are similar to your conventional beam. So stress distribution at top there will be compression, and at bottom there will be tension. So when you add, due to the principle of superposition, you add them together, you will obtain that compression. Add them to compression, and compression and tensile, from compression minus the tensile stresses, and you will get this one. So compressive stresses have increased at the top, and at the bottom there is also compressive stresses, while in conventional beam there are tensile stresses at the bottom, and concrete is no more resisting these tensile stresses. By but here this concrete is still resisting compressive stresses when load is applied. So you can see that so if you keep on increasing the load, then there will be concrete will stop resisting the compressive stresses, and stop resisting the tensile stresses, and the member will be subjected to tensile stresses at the bottom. So this compressive stresses will reduce, and with the more passage of time, start cracks will start developing. Here you can see that a beam has been provided, a reinforced concrete crack under the load. Load means a reinforced concrete beam, and the load is applied, and it will start cracking, and post tensioned concrete before loading. So before loading, you have applied a post tensioning. You have tensioned it, the member, and post tensioned it, and a camber has been formed. Upward deflection is called camber. So when load is applied, so it will straighten the member, and while you can see, if you are applying directly loading on the conventional beam, it will start cracking, directly start cracking, while here you have one additional layer of security, is that first the member will start straightening, and then it will start deflection. And in cantilever case, this was simply supported case, and in cantilever case you can see that tension is at top, and compression is at bottom. So we provide tension reinforcement at the top of the member. So when load is applied, cracks develop at the tensile stresses, tensile side. And if you post tensioned it, needs as pre-stressing steel is provided, and tensioning is applied at the pre-stressing strands. So it will form a little camber, downwards camber, and when load is applied it will straighten and then it will deflect. Advantages of pre-stressing: pre-stress concrete sections are thinner and lighter than RCC sections, so it is a major disadvantage. Since high strength concrete and steel are used in pre-stress concrete, so when you are using pre-stress, so you there is no area of using normal strength concrete. You must be using high strength concrete, otherwise pre-stressing will be relaxed in normal strength concrete, as they are quite lower in density and strength. So when you are using high strength concrete and high strength steel, so automatically your section will get thinner and lighter. In pre-stressed concrete, whole concrete area is effective in resisting load, unlike RCC where concrete below the neutral axis is neglected. So in conventional reinforced concrete design, you must have studied that below the neutral axis concrete is considered to be non-resistive and they are not resisting any tensile stresses. While in pre-stressing steel, we assume that concrete whole member of the cross section keep on resisting the forces. Thinner section in pre-stress concrete result in less self weight and hence overall economy. So when you are using thinner and lighter members, so self weight will be less, and if you are constructing a tall building, so your overall economy will be efficient. Long span bridges and flyovers are made of pre-stress concrete because of lesser self weight and thinner sections. So long span bridges and flyovers are mostly of pre-stress concrete, and previously they would be used conventionally. Reinforcement would be used in the girders of the bridges, but now all the bridges are almost pre-stressed concrete. So pre-stressed concrete is used heavily in loaded structures. Yeah, it's true. Pre-stressed concrete members show less deflection. Yeah, we have studied that why it shows less deflection, that it forms a camber, and when load is applied, first it will straighten the member and then deflection will occur. While in conventional member, RCC member, when load is applied directly, it will start deflection. So why it shows less deflection, there is a reason. So all these points have some reason and connection in your previous lecture slides. Since the concrete does not crack in pre-stressed concrete, rusting of the steel is minimized. Yeah, sure, it means in conventional member, due to loading, there is a cracking beneath at the tension side of the member, and when crack is initiated, there are openings or weak pockets below the member, and if there is some humidity in the moisture or rain penetrates inside, and your steel will get rusted, and it will reduce its strength with the passage of time. While in pre-stressing, you can see that due to higher loadings, even your stress, there are no cracking developed, so your member is intact, so it will be less susceptible to rusting of the steel. Pre-stressing concrete is used in structures where tension develops, or the structure is subjected to vibrations, impacts, shocks, like girders, bridges, railway sleepers, electric poles, gravity dams. So major construction is done by the pre-stressed concrete. So means critical members, it is indirectly stating that critical members are designed as pre-stressed concrete. Pre-stressed members like electric poles and railway sleepers are produced in factories using simple pre-stressing methods. Yeah, they are ready pre-cast members, and high span to depth ratio, larger spans possible with pre-stressing bridges, buildings with large column free spaces. Typical values of span to depth ratios in the slab are given. means larger spans can be achieved by applying the pre-stressing concrete and by the provision of the pre-stressing steel in your concrete. So larger spans means larger span bridges, and also if you are constructing an auditorium or a stadium where you want least number of columns, then you should prefer a pre-stressing concrete. So now you can see that comparison has been done. Normal pre-stress non-pre-stress concrete slab, so 28:1, this is span, if that is 28 feet and depth 1 feet. If slab depth is 1 feet, then 28 feet you can construct, and while pre-stress slab, if that is 1 feet depth of the slab, then you can construct 45 feet of the span. So how much increase? Almost double the span you can construct with the help of pre-stressing steel, by incorporation pre-stressing steel. For the same span, less depth compared to the reinforced concrete. You can see that span is same. For the same span, less depth is compared to the, okay, if you are, means in this one, you have kept depth same and spans have been kept variable. If you keep this span constant, then depth will of pre-stress will be quite lesser as compared to depth of non-pre-stress slab. Suitable for precast construction are rapid construction, and so means pre-stressing steel is suitable for precast construction, that because in precast construction you have to construct rapidly and better quality control and reduced maintenance, and suitable for repetitive construction and multiple use of formwork is in availability of the standard shear. So these are basic advantages of precast construction, and so precast construction is rapid and better quality, and maintenance is easy, and repetitive construction and multiple use of formwork and standard shape. So means they are more suitable, pre-stressing steel is more suitable for precast construction. The following figure shows the common types of precast sections, so T section and double T section and hollow core and piles and I girder, T girder, L girder and H girders. Different sections of precast sections can be formulated by the use of pre-stressing steel. Disadvantages of pre-stressing. Pre-stressing concrete construction requires very good quality and supervision. Yeah, this is certain, that very good quality of concrete is required. A lot of admixtures, retarders are used, and higher supervision is required. Cost of material used in pre-stress is quite high. High strength steel is about 3 times costlier than mild steel, so cost of the material is quite high. Material also include concrete and admixtures and other additives. Pre-stress concrete requires specialized tensioning equipment and devices which are very costly. So means irrespective of the usable consumable material, there are also means equipment and devices are also specialized. And every specialized item is initially quite costly. Pre-stressed concrete sections are more brittle because of use of high tension steel. Yeah, pre-stressed concrete are brittle. Pre-stressed concrete constructed buildings and structures are quite brittle. The comparison between reinforced cement concrete and pre-stressed concrete. In RCC beam, the concrete in the compression side of the neutral side of the axis alone is effective. The concrete in the tension side of the neutral axis is ineffective, but the in pre-stress concrete beam, the entire section is effective. We have gone through this that concrete above the neutral axis is effective in resisting compressive stresses, while in below the neutral axis concrete is not considered to resist any type of stresses. While it is pre-stressed concrete beam, entire section is effective. Reinforced concrete beam are generally heavy, yeah, and they always need shear reinforcement besides the longitudinal reinforcement for flexure. Pre-stressed concrete beams are lighter, and by providing the curved tendons and pre-compression, and a considerable part of shear is resisted. So means a considerable part of the shear can be resisted because of pre-compression and curved tendons. In reinforced concrete beams, high strength concrete is not needed. Okay, in conventional reinforcement RCC, normal strength concrete can be used, but in pre-stressed concrete beams, high strength concrete and high strength steel are necessary. High strength concrete is needed to resist high stresses at anchorages, and high strength steel is needed to transfer large stresses. So in pre-stressing, high strength steels are required, while in normal reinforcement, normal strength concrete is required. Reinforced concrete beams, being massive and heavy, are more suitable in situations where weight is more desired than strength. Okay, this is important benefit of the reinforced concrete beams. Normally reinforced concrete beams and pre-stressed concrete beams are very suitable for heavy loads and longer spans. So heavy loads and longer spans, they are required. They are slender and artistic treatments can be provided. Cracks do not occur under working loads, and even if minute cracks occur when overloaded, such cracks get closed when the overload is removed. The deflection of the pre-stressed concrete beam is small. So deflection is quite small. In reinforced concrete beams, there is no way testing the steel and concrete. In pre-stressed concrete beams, testing of the steel and concrete can be made while pre-stressing. So this is also a major advantage, that in reinforced concrete, you cannot test the materials, steel and concrete, while you are casting, and while in pre-stressed concrete beams, testing of the steel and concrete can be done while pre-stressing. So we study different types of pre-stressing, internal pre-stressing and internal pre-stressing. In this type, a pre-stressing force is applied to the high tensile steel, that is steel reinforcement. It induces internal compressive stresses in concrete. It is the most commonly used method because of ease and accurate application. Internal pre-stressing can be done in two methods, pre-tensioning and post-tensioning. So means in pre-stressing, what is done, that high tensile strength steel, that is steel reinforced, high tensile steel is provided, and with the help of jacking, tensile stresses are induced in those steel reinforcements, and concrete is casted, and then these tension steels are released, and they will start applying compressive stresses at the edge of the beam. So mostly used, there are two different methods of pre-stressing, pre-tensioning and post-tensioning. So in pre-tensioning, what we are doing is this, that concrete is poured first. Tensile steel is tensioned and then concrete is poured, while in post-tensioning, first concrete is poured and then steel is tensioned. So order of sequence is changed. Sequence of concreting is changed in first pre-tensioning, before and tensioning. Before we are doing tensioning, before casting we are doing pre-tensioning, and after casting we are doing post-tensioning. External pre-stressing, this method is not commonly used. In this method, the pre-stressing is done by adjusting the external reactions by inducing different support conditions, and the external pre-stressing system requires very much accuracy in the planning and applications. The method of pre-stressing involves pre-tensioning and post-tensioning methods. Okay, in this, what we do is that some additional supports are provided, and externally pre-stressing steel is provided, and they are externally pre-tensioned, and post-tensioning and pre-tensioning both can be provided. So external application of pre-stressing, we have studied that pre-stressing include pre-tensioning and post-tensioning. and pre-stressing are internal when that is internal to the concrete section, and external when that pre-stressing strands and pre-stressing elements are external to the concrete section. So this is the major difference between internal pre-stressing and external pre-stressing. So this is external pre-stressing. You can see that a girder is there, and a support has been artificially created, and these are tensioned, and this will raise the this girder. And you can see that inside this post-tensioning is provided, and this is slab, and post-tensioning is provided. Other types, external and internal pre-stressing. This classification is based on the location of the pre-stressing tendons with respect to the concrete section. If that pre-stressing tendons are inside the concrete section, that is internal pre-stressing, and if pre-stressing tendons are outside the concrete section, that is external pre-stressing. And we have studied that pre-stressing include both pre-tensioning and post-tensioning. Okay, second category of pre-stressing is pre-tensioning or post-tensioning. This is the most important classification and is based on the sequence of casting the concrete and applying tension to the tendons. So this is important classification, and based on the sequence of the casting means if you are applying tension to the tendon before concreting, then that is pre-tensioning. And if you are applying tension to the tendon after concreting, then that is post-tensioning. Linear or circular pre-stressing, this classification is based on the shape of the member pre-stressed. If your member is a linear beam element, slab element, then that is linear pre-stressing. And circular pre-stressing, if that is overhead tank or some nuclear reactor containment, some circular containment, then that is circular pre-stressing. Okay, this is a buttress, and circular pre-stressing has been provided, and Hoyer's long line system of pre-stress pre-tensioning. You can see that different beams are placed, and proper abutments are provided, supports at the end are provided, a formwork is provided, and pre-stressing strand is passed, and here with the help of jacks, here it is anchored, and at the other end pre-stressing strands are pre-tensioned, and then jacks are removed, and casting is carried out, and when casting concrete has hardened enough, then these wires are cut. So you get the pre-stressed beam. Okay, different developments in the concrete are plain concrete when no reinforcement of any type, conventional reinforcement or pre-stressing reinforcement has not been provided. That is called plain concrete, and PCC, Portland plain concrete, and this is when conventional normal mild steel reinforcement has been provided. So that is reinforced concrete, and RCC, reinforced cement concrete, plain cement concrete, and when pre-stressing strands and tendons are provided, then pre-stressed concrete, and when conventional and pre-stressed concrete both are provided, then that is partially pre-stressed concrete. This is fully pre-stressed concrete, and this is partially pre-stressed concrete, and when fibers are introduced, carbon fibers or asbestos fibers or artificial or natural synthetic fibers are incorporated, that is fiber reinforced concrete. And when all these pre-stressing is also provided, and conventional reinforcement is also provided, and fiber reinforcement is also provided, then that is called hybrid structural concrete. Important thing is this, that plain concrete, why we incorporated these different types of reinforcements. These are developments in modern and this is almost a mode type of structural element. Plain concrete was weaker in resisting tensile stresses, so we provided reinforcement bars. So then we provided plain concrete pre-tension, pre-stress, so for normal flexural resistance and that shear resistance, we cannot afford pre-stressing tendons, and for that, and also that shrinkage reinforcement, pre-stressing steel cannot be provided. So for that purposes, we provide conventional reinforcement, and so we get partially pre-stressed concrete. And moreover, the phenomena is this, that if that is external camber or deflection, whatever the case, then due to fracture mechanics, we have come to know that cracks are initiated at nano level. Previously that was at micro level, and then at nano level, then secondary reinforcement has been provided. So due to this, these fibers have crack suppression, crack bridging, and they suppress the crack initiation at the nano level. And even carbon nanotubes are incorporated, and now modern structures have composite type of construction. Fourth type of pre-stressing is category is full, partial, or limited pre-stressing. Based on the these are based on the amount of pre-stressing force. Three types of pre-stressing are defined as full pre-stressing. When the level of pre-stressing is such that no tensile stress is allowed in concrete under service load, is called full pre-stressing. When all the tensile forces are resisted by the pre-stressing, then and conventional reinforcement all together, then that is called full pre-stressing. And partial pre-stressing, when the level of pre-stressing is such that under tensile stresses due to service load, the crack width is within the allowable limit, it is called partial pre-stressing. So when crack width is within the allowable limit, then that is called partial pre-stressing. And limited pre-stressing, when the level of pre-stressing is such that the tensile stresses under service load is within the crack cracking stress of concrete, and it is called limited pre-stressing. So means these are not based on the crack width, and they are based on the cracking stresses. And it cracking stresses of the concrete should be within the, means tensile stresses should be within the cracking stresses of the concrete. These are called limited pre-stressing. So you can see that load or moment versus curvature or deflection, load versus deflection and moment versus curvature relationship has been presented. And you can see that these are loadings, dead load, and here is live load. And if dead load and live load are added together, then these are service loads. And if you are multiplying those dead load with the multiplying factor and live load with this factor of safety, then that is called factor or factorized or ultimate load. So you can see that when reinforced concrete, normal reinforced concrete is used, and due to dead load here it will come, and due to live load here it will come, and factored load, this is the ultimate or ultimate load carrying capacity, factored load. Okay, if partial pre-stress is applied, and you have studied that in partial pre-stress, crack widths are within the allowable limit. So due to service loads, crack widths are in allowable within limits. So ultimate ultimate over reinforced and ultimate under reinforcements. Okay, then the second third category is fully pre-stressed. Fully pre-stressed is shown by this reddish line. So you can see that at service load there is no cracking So you can see that cracking is here. So cracking is, so in reinforced concrete, cracking is at dead load, and in partially pre-stressed, cracking is at some crack width is controlled and it is within service load, but some percentage of live load plus dead load. And when it is fully pre-stressed, then it is beyond service loads, then crack can initiate. And you can see that this area of the stress strain curve shows the camber here in our initial present that slide. We saw a stress strain curve, comparative stress strain curve, and I told you that we will see it later. Where it is, this one. So load versus you can construct a similar graph, load versus deflection, moment versus curvature, or stress versus strain. So mild steel, load versus deflection, then deflection is at zero, and here deflection is negative because of the formation of camber. Alright, then similarly here, no pre-stress. If no pre-stress is provided, then a lot of you can see that deflection is, and if limited pre-stress and partial pre-stress, then full pre-stress, you can see that with the incorporation of pre-stressing, the greater the pre-stressing, the more the less the ductility is. More the brittleness and the rest the ductility. Alright, fifth category of types of pre-stressing is uniaxial, biaxial, or multiaxial pre-stressing. As the name suggests, the classification is based on the direction of the pre-stressing member. If pre-stressing is in one direction, then it is uniaxial pre-stress, and if pre-stressing is in both directions, then that is biaxial pre-stressing, and if in three directions, then that is triaxial pre-stressing. Uniaxial pre-stressing is seen in beams and linear elements, and biaxial pre-stressing is seen in slabs. Okay, uniaxial pre-stressing is also beams, posts, columns. So straight lined elements are called having uniaxial pre-stressing, and planar elements like slabs, plates, and those have biaxial pre-stressing, and triaxial have 3D structures, have domes and funicular type of structures have can have triaxial pre-stressing. Uniaxial pre-stressing, biaxial pre-stressing, hydrostatic or triaxial stressing. You can see this one, a slab is shown, and conventional reinforcement is also shown, and these ducts for pre-stressing steel is also shown, and you can see that ducts for electric, okay, this is duct for grouting purposes, means when concrete is poured afterwards, and here it will be grouting will be done in this duct. Okay, here it is domed shown, and stresses have been shown, and due to resolution you can see that almost in three directional and dimensions stresses are incorporated. Alright, methods of pre-stressing. This classification is based on the method by which pre-stressing force is generated. Okay, how you are going to generate the pre-stressing force. Most these are four sources: hydraulic pre-stressing, hydraulics is used, hydraulic oil, and mechanical pre-stressing, and electrical pre-stressing, and chemical pre-stressing. Let's discuss them one by one. Hydraulic pre-stressing, this is the simplest type of pre-stressing, produced a large pre-stressing force. And hydraulic jacks used for the tensioning of the tendons comprises of calibrated pressure gauges which directly indicates the magnitude of the force developed during the tensioning. So hydraulic jacks are used and due to mobile pumping and these are tensed and there are gauges which shows the reading of the tension. So multi-stranded hydraulic jack and a single strand hydraulic jack. In single strand hydraulic jack, a single strand can be tensioned, and in multi-strand hydraulic jack, multiple strands can be tensioned at once. So in larger projects, multi-strand hydraulic jack will be used, and in smaller projects, a single strand hydraulic jack will be used. Okay, in slabs, smaller residential slabs, single strand hydraulic jack should be used, and in auditoriums and those slabs, multi-strand hydraulic jacks should be used. Mechanical pre-stressing. In this type of pre-stressing, the devices includes weights or with or without lever transmission, gear transmission in conjunction with the pulley blocks, screw jacks with or without gear drives and wire winding machines. So with the help of weights and pulleys and wire windings, mechanically pre-stressing can be carried out, but in current circumstances mostly pre-stressing is carried out by hydraulic jacking. Mechanical pre-stressing has been extant now. Electrical pre-stressing. This type of pre-stressing, the steel wires are electrically heated and anchored before placing concrete in the molds. Okay, steel wires are electrically heated, and this type of pre-stressing is known as thermoelectric pre-stressing. Another terminology for electrical pre-stressing is thermoelectric pre-stressing. In modern type of pre-stressing, electricity with low voltage and high current is used for a duct forming a current member, concrete member, and surfer coating on the steel bars as duct material. While supplying electricity in the structure, sulfur get melted up because heat generated on the steel bars of the structure. No provision of any duct formation is required in concrete structural element. High strength steel structure could be anchored by tightening nuts at the both ends. So in electrical pre-stressing, what is done, that there's pre-stressing reinforcement is covered with the sulfur, and electricity is passed, and that due to low voltage and high electricity, this sulfur coating is melted, and it generates heat, and due to heating these strands are extended, and then they are anchored and tightened by the nuts and bolts, nuts at the end, as a bolt ends, and then these strands are cut at the end of the concrete member. Okay, four type of method of pre-stressing is chemical pre-stressing. In chemical method, expanding cements are used, and high degree of expansion is controlled by varying the curing condition. So control is the waiting curing, and in electrical control was sulfur and current, and mechanical screw jacks and pulley. Weights is the controlling, and hydraulic is the hydraulic jack is the hydraulic pump. In chemical, okay, since expansive action of cement while setting is restrained, and it induces tensile forces in tendons and compressive stresses in concrete, and typical expanding cement may consist of around 75% Portland cement and 15% high aluminum cement and 10% gypsum. Using this cement, a linear expansion of around 3 to 4% may be achieved in concrete. Linear expansion. Okay, when concrete expands, the tension tendons also expand in length, and tensile pre-stress are introduced in tendons. These tensile stresses are transferred to concrete in the form of compressive stresses. So basically, in pre-stressing, chemical pre-stressing, expanding cements are used as a binding agent, and when cement is used, so with the passage of time, they keep on expanding and in controlled curing, and when they expand, the internally placed pre-stressing tendons get stretched, and pre-stressing tensile stresses are generated in pre-stressing steel. Okay, pre-tensioning is basically summarized here in this method. Pre-stressing is induced, the tensions are tensioned before concrete is placed. It is done in factories. In this method, the tendons are enclosed temporarily against some abutments, and then they are pulled by using jack type devices. The concrete is placed while maintaining the tension. When concrete is hardened sufficiently, the tendons are released slowly or cut. This will transfer pre-stress from the steel to concrete through bond, and this type of pre-stressing method is commonly used of small size members like beams, slabs, piles, sleepers, and electric poles, which can be cast easily in factories. So in pre-tensioning, pre-stress force is applied pre-stress force is applied before concreting, and then concreting is done, and then they are slowly released and cut. So in small size members, beams, slabs, piles, sleepers, and electric poles, they are prepared and casted in factories by pre-tensioning method. The steel tensioned before casting the concrete, and strands are tensioned. Strands are tensioned, concrete is cast around the strands, and then strands release when concrete attains the required strength. Pre-stressing force induces into the concrete by bond. So these are the pre-stressing steps: anchoring of the tendon against the end abutments, and placing of the jacks, applying tension to the tendon, casting of the concrete, and cutting of the tendons. So this is the basic process of the pre-tensioning. Abutment is placed, and steel tendon is placed, jack tension is applied, and concreting is done, and pre-stressing strands are cut. Transfer of the pre-stress. This is the simple process of pre-tensioning. Okay, this is hydraulic jack with the load cell. Means these are placed at the end, and they are jacked. Okay, at one end they are fixed, and another end jacking is conducted. Harping devices. Tendons are frequently bent, except in case of slabs on grade and poles and piles. The tendons are bent, harped in between the supports with a shallow sag. So means in between, sometimes your pre-tensioning is carried at the upper end, and with the passage, means the more it goes inside, and then it will be lower, and then it will be upside. So your tension strands are start from this corner. In a simply supported case, it start from this corner and below, and then up. So this below, how you are going to maintain its eccentricity from the neutral axis? So with the help of harping devices, they are placed at the center, and they give you a harp or bend to the those things, and then they are after concreting, they are removed. view of the tendon layout and casting bed. It is a layout and casting bed, and you can see that harping devices are placed and tendons. This is end abutment. These are rods. So when concrete is poured and these are cut here, from here. Jacking abutments, they are jacking the abutment. Installing formwork for concreting. Conventional reinforcement is also visible. Taking of formwork concreting has been carried done, and a few of the reinforcement from the eye girder is visible from upside, so that means when they are placed on the girders, on the columns, on the piers of the flyover or bridge, then a monolithic slab can be casted at site in situ. So detensioning, sometimes heating is used, and this guy is using heat for this purpose. This is not recommended, as these will disrupt the tensioning, so they should be cut it. And this is your final pre-tensioned product. Alright, in this simple lecture we studied pre-stressing, and in particular to pre-tensioning, and in upcoming lecture we will be studying pre-stress in particular to post-tensioning. And let me remind you one thing, that pre-stress is also one of the major category of precast concreting. And in precast concreting nowadays, modern structures all are having pre-tensioning and pre-tensioning or post-tensioning. So these are these can be subcategorized of can be made subcategory of the precast concreting. So if you want to specialize precast concreting, then you should also know and get expertise in pre-stressing. So a simple lecture. And in upcoming lectures we will come up with more fascinating topics, and that's it from today. And thank you. Assalamu alaikum.